let's start with this session, which is which we'll be talking about how to develop augmented reality using Zebra devices. So my name is Laurent Trudu. I'm a sales engineer at Zebra, and my main occupation is helping people, helping customers on how to implement their solution on our devices and on everything that is software related. So this presentation, there are lots of things to say, so we will start first with concepts about augmented reality that will be useful for you in the future, and then we will go to some programming stuff in the end. But since it's pretty some stuff are pretty complex, it's more for your knowledge, and with the right resources, you will be able to develop quickly augmented reality application. So first thing first, what is augmented reality? In a general way, augmented reality is taking some input from sensors, processing them, and then you provide some sensory feedback to a human being. This sensory feedback can be visual, like 3D overlays, they can be auditive, like sounds, or haptic, like vibration. And it can be done on live processing or offline processing. So let's take a look at some augmented reality examples that you already see in your everyday life. Like the camera at the back of your car, which will indicate you where you're going to go according to your will. It gives you some feedback on your actual reality. Simplest thing like a kettle, which will give you information on the temperature, and even a barcode reader, which can say to you it's a right barcode or a wrong barcode. It's augmented reality in a general, generally speaking. More advanced stuff like graphical overlay. The NFL uses Zebra's devices to track players in real time during the game. And then they can overlay information on the screen, and this information are helping you to understand what is going on, because it can be pretty complex, so you use computer and you provide information that you can easily understand. Augmented reality is not only providing you some more intelligence, it's here too, you are at your here too, it's augmented reality, it's providing information that maybe not the one you would like. So first thing first, the most important thing in augmented reality is object recognition. Everything you will do will be based on object recognition. So what is object recognition? Object recognition is the action of using the signature of an object to detect it on a live stream or on a fly stream. And from your knowledge of this object, you can estimate the position of the object, the rotation of the object, where it is in your real world. How do we do object recognition? You have to create a signature of this object, a digital signature, a way to find it on your video screen. So let's cut the things and look at the definition, the signature of the lemon. Everybody here can recognize the lemon. It's yellow, it's oval, and it has a texture surface. That's how augmented reality is done. You just take feature from an image, you compose them, you create a signature, and you use it to find back your object on the reality you are recording. So another concept that is very important in augmented reality is pose estimation. Everything you will do will be related to the object you are seeing. So augmented reality relies on algorithm that helps you to find where the camera, that gives you the information on where the camera is relatively to your object. Everything in our world is projected. Your two eyes, they are taking two images, you put them, you process them inside your brain, and you get your 3D representation. But there are many sensors that are used, many information that you already know about the object. For example, if I take a look at this box, I know its size, I know its cubic, I know its face. I know that if I look at them like that, I'm facing them. If I look at them like that, I'm on top of them. And you are doing pose estimation. all the time in your everyday life. It's very important to understand this concept because later on it will influence the way of you are going to program your overlays and your 3D information. So, how do we do the characterization of such an object in augmented reality? We cut off every faces, we put them on a virtual box, and then we process it and we get a signature. And we can create a database with many signatures, and this database will be used to recognize your objects. So let's talk about spaces. Everything in augmented reality or in 3D mostly is related to spaces. You have local spaces, the spaces of your object. You have world spaces, where your object is situated in the world. You have camera spaces. Camera spaces is what is your camera looking from and how will it project the 3D on the 2D plane. So spaces, object model spaces is based on the barycenter of your, can be based on the barycenter of your object you choose. The simplest way is that. You can define the position of all the vertices of your object relatively to this center. So the description of your object will be done according to its barycenter. But then you want to put this object somewhere in your space. So you have a world spaces with a different origin, which may be here. So if I want to put it at 5 cm far, I translate it from 5 cm. And same thing here, it's a world spaces. Then you have the eyes spaces. This is a camera spaces. It's what you are seeing and where, what is your position relatively to all these objects. In augmented reality, this is this space. We are going to use mainly this space, because everything will be related to what you are looking at, and we see it on different on later slides. So here we are talking about the latest, the way how do we transform this object from the model space to the world space to the camera space. We use mathematical objects that are called matrices. You don't have to know the underlying mathematics of it. You just have to know that matrices helps you to transform your objects. Matrices helps you to rotate, scale, translate your objects. And matrices is the final step to project your 3D object on your 2D plane. When you are working on 3D, you need to render only everything that you are seeing, because I don't need to render this object if it's beside me. I need to render it if it's here. Same thing for the field of view. I don't need it there. I need it there. So all the time you will have to define what you want to render, what you want to see, what is the space you want to use. And for this, you are using something called custom. You will see it during your work on augmented reality. Custom is this thing. It's a pyramid of vision. And one last thing, later on I will talk about dimensions. Dimensions are important, and you need to know this thing because you will provide your near field. I mean, everything that is there won't be rendered, and everything that is there won't be rendered. So you have to need to provide these dimensions according to the dimension of the space you are working on. I will give you more information about it later. So transformation matrices, the mathematics. Beautiful. You won't use it, fortunately. Don't be afraid, you won't use it. But it's just here to know that you can do translation, rotation, and scaling. Forget about skewing. Skewing is a way of deforming everything. If you want to do something psychedelic, you can do skewing. But nobody does skewing right now. Or maybe if you want to do some jelly synth effects. So why am I talking about matrices? Because since matrices are used to make transformation on your objects, you have to compose them. You have to compose if you want to do a translation and a rotation, you get a result. But if you do first a rotation and then a translation, it's not the same result. And it's the same thing in real life. If your origin is here, if you put your object here, no, it's not a good place. Maybe let's say the origin is here. If I put my object here and I want to rotate it like that, and then I want to translate it like that, my object, final destination is here. If I start translating my object first and rotating it against the origin, it goes there. It's not really the same result. So sometimes you may encounter some problems with matrix order, so you have to know this. It will be easier for you when you develop. If you see something that goes wrong, lots of time it's due to your matrix transformation order. And you will see later that you won't have to know matrix is either the underlying mathematics. So 3D rendering, in this example, we are using a commercial API that is called Vuforia, and on Vuforia and on Android, we are using OpenGL Embedded System 2.0 API. OpenGL is a graphic library that has been made by Silicon Graphics in 1996. Silicon Graphics is a company that provides the computers to do Jurassic Park. They provide the chipset for the Nintendo 64 to do 3D rendering. So those people were the initiator, we can say, of 3D in the industry. Since 2006, the OpenGL consortium Kronos Group has taken lead on OpenGL. So right now, it's not anymore a commercial API or maintained by a commercial company, it's a non-profit consortium. And you will use OpenGL to render the object. So let's talk about Vuforia. Vuforia is the API we are going to use to create augmented reality application on our Zebra device. So why Vuforia? First thing first, Vuforia is a commercial API. So you will get all the support that you can expect from a commercial API. You will get samples, lots of things. Vuforia was previously owned by Qualcomm. And since 2015, it's on the PTC. It has lots of customers that are using it, 3M, Toyota, lots of big customers, and a very strong developer base. So what Vuforia can do? Vuforia can help you to detect 2D objects, like images in a magazine, and put something, some overlay on top of it. It can help you to detect specific objects like box or cylinders, mugs. It can help you to detect more complex objects. You will use a scanner that is provided by Vuforia, and you can create a signature of complex object based on the contrast of these objects. But if your object is not contrasted enough, Vuforia has announced recently that they will provide a way to detect CAD objects. So this is a very important step in augmented reality. What you saw the first day, augmented glasses that were showing some overlay stuff on an engine, it's pretty tricky to do because an engine doesn't have specific contrast and it's very complex object. So if you take your graphical description of this object, for example, Peugeot or Citroën have everything that is done inside CATIA 3D software. So you can take directly your 3D models, import it in Vuforia, and it will detect it. So what you saw on the first day is a reality now. I mean, you can do it when they will release it in a few months. You will be able to do it. So Vuforia provide a way to do offline detection with a local database, but cloud detection too, with a cloud database. And the most important thing, it has, it's on the next slide, sorry. Most important thing, it has a very small footprint, and it's very fast, and it's very easy to do, and you can use it on several devices. Zebras and Android devices, but phones and tablets as well, Windows-based computer, digital anywhere. So it's you can do it on several devices. So just a little break. Why TC8000? Just a simple thing. I presented this demonstration on an exhibition, and I used it for the whole day. And in the end of the day, I still had 30% of my battery. So this is, in augmented reality, this is really impressive. If you take your classic phone, if it's not a Pixel, I think, I didn't try a Pixel, but with a classic phone, you can get 1 hour maybe 1.5 hours, and some smartphone 20 minutes max. With this, you can do a whole day of augmented reality. So let's talk about the resources that Euphoria will provide you as a commercial API. So the first thing first, you have to register yourself on the developer portal of Euphoria to access all of these resources. From this portal, you will be able to download the SDK. It's pretty simple. It's a jar file that you include in your application. And you have, for people who want to have more fun or more difficulty, who like challenges, you can use native libs that are ARM compiled to do C++ development, to develop your application in C++. You will get access at samples. Samples are really important because some parts of the initialization, for example, of the OpenGL engine can be tricky. With a sample, you have all the necessary architecture to start your application. And you will see it because I've based this demonstration on one sample, and it allows me to do it very quickly. And it still is an enterprise architecture. It's not samples like very simple samples. They are very good, well programmed. You have advanced samples, as it's said, to do advanced things like special effects on your camera. And mostly in the field of best practices, you will see a sample on how to implement cloud recognition if you want to do cloud recognition. So the library, this is where you find all the documentation. So we can everything, getting started, how to do best practices, whatever, everything you will need is there. And there are lots of information, which is very, very interesting. And finally, you have access to a commercial API support. And since it's commercial, there is a license. So, the good thing, the developer license is free. So, you can start to have fun tomorrow. You just click on the tab, you say, I want a developer license, and you get it. And in 5 minutes, you can start developing. Then you have two other different licenses, the customer targeted license and the enterprise targeted license. It depends if you want your application to be public or if you want it to be inside your enterprise. And the smallest fee is $99 for cloud recognition only. So,
as I said before, what does this mean if you can get back to the previous slide? What does this mean? 1,000 cloud recognitions per month. Exactly.
It means that it's for consumer and enterprise license. It means that you can use a local database to do your recognition, but you have access to the cloud recognition within your application. And the cloud recognition database is something that is hosted at the
industry. But this number 1,000. What does it mean? It's
one for the
developer.
Exactly.
So this means
that you can do only 1,000 hits on the cloud database per month. That's what it means.
What is Roomark?
Roomark is some kind of QR code that has been made by Euphoria. It's Euphoria marking code. It's the same thing as QR code, but more complex. You can do it's not QR code like rectangles. It can be directly integrated inside your logo, for example. You put some points everywhere and it can be recognized in your logo. So your logo can be a source of augmented reality. So the license, as I said before, you go to the license manager, you click add the license key, you select developer, you got it, and you can run it.
Last question, is it possible to get divis on logo? And I know where is the logo positioned in the area. Can I get the, how I look at it? Where am I?
You will see.
Oh.
Not where you are in your it's a more complex use case, but there is a Q&A part at the end of the presentation. I will be pleased to talk about it at the end of the presentation. So let's talk about the demo application we want to implement. So it's a pretty simple use case. We have the palette. Okay, everybody knows the palette. And we have several objects. We have two palettes, in fact, palette one and palette two. Some of these objects, pizza, soup, salmon, couscous goes to palette one and the other goes to palette two. So we want to implement an augmented reality application that will help our co-worker to do this this use case the fastest possible. So we want to provide some visual information in the form of, let's say, color, green for good, red for wrong, some sound, and some haptic feedback vibrations. And everything will be related to the fact this object goes to palette one, this object goes to palette two. So the first step, we go back to our concept, the object characterization. We have to do a database to allow us to recognize our objects. So the first step, as I said before, we just cut off. You can take your camera, you take picture of every part of your object. There are applications on the App Store, on Google App Store, that can do that for you in an easy way. But you can do it directly with an image editing software, a simple one like Paint.net. And you extract every faces of your object. And then it goes to database creation. So, database creation, pretty simple. You have a tab for this, you select it. You hit on add database, you create your name of database, and you click on add target to add a target. Pretty straightforward. And then we will be prompted, what kind of object do you want to recognize? Is it a truly single image? Is it a cuboid? Is it a cylinder? Or is it some kind of 3D object that you scanned before with before your application? So for our use case, it's cuboid object. And then you have to describe your cuboid object. So this part is really important. This one is a name, it's user data, you can put whatever you want and use it later in your application to know what you are recognizing. But this, here you will define your object according to his dimension. As I said before, everything is related to what you see. For example, if I want to recognize this object and if it's 5 centimeters long, if I move my camera from this point to this point, I will go 5 centimeters. I will go by 5 units in the virtual space. So if I want to do a car is, for example, 2 meters long. It's 200 centimeters, which means it means that if I go from the back of the car with my camera to the front of my car, it will go by 200 units in the virtual space. You have to take this into account because it will change the way you define the famous frustum. Because if you put an airplane at 5 and a far plane at 10 centimeters or maybe 20 units, you will be able to recognize an object like this with such dimensions. But if you try to recognize your car, which is 200 centimeters far long, you won't see anything because it will be this beyond your far plane. So it's important to know that everything is related to your dimensions. Keep that in mind. Once we have defined the size of our object, we are going to define characterize the object by giving the database every picture we have taken with our camera previously. And this will create the characterization of our object. And in the end, you will see the list of all objects here. As you see for the demonstration, we've added 2 QR codes and many objects. From here, you can download your database for all offline usage. You will get a zip file with a .dat file. The .dat file contains a binary definition, the characterization of the image inside your object. The XML file will contain the dimensions that you have entered previously, as well as the name. So if you want to change it later, you can do it by editing the XML file. So demo application, let's talk about a little bit of the Vuforia architecture. So if you want to create an AR application, you only need two, basically you only need two classes. One is the Android activity, because you have to take care of the Android lifecycle. If you go on pause, on resume, you have to inform the Vuforia engine that something is going on the Android part. It is there that you can implement everything that is business related, I mean another class, but you access it from your activity. You can do everything that is related to the initialization of the Fourier engine here. And the second part is the GL surface view. The GL surface view will host the OpenGL rendering engine. This is where you do all the OpenGL parts. Okay. You won't do that because it's complicated. You have many things to do if you start from scratch with your two classes. Best is to use the samples, and I will show you later why. Let's talk about the internal architecture of the Fourier. We will use many classes, four classes. The Fourier class, this is where you put your license. This is where you are going, you are being able to register some callbacks that will inform you at any frame what is the state of my tracker. Am I tracking one object? What is the object I am tracking? What is its position? You can access everything from the Fourier class. The camera device, it's a single button, and it's where you are going to configure your camera, the size of your view, and this is what will transmit the information to the tracker class. The tracker class contains all the algorithms that are used to recognize your objects. This is inside the tracker class that you will load your database. This is there. You can load as many databases as you want. Only one can be active at the same time. And you load them inside the tracker class. And finally, the renderer will help you to render the camera view. What the camera is seeing at one point, and you have access through the renderer to the trackers too, if you want it, and it's useful when you are inside your rendering loop. So to do that, we have to initialize everything. We have to set up the camera device, we have to set up the tracker, we have to set up the renderer. That's why the sample are interesting, because the sample will provide you two simple classes that you will be able to modify for your own purposes, and everything that is related to the 3D engine initialization will be done in other classes. So let's talk about how do we develop this demo. So developing the demo, first thing first, we downloaded the sample. We extracted it, and then we just imported it in Android Studio, and we had this. The samples are more complex. I've just removed everything that was not related to project tracking. So what do you really need to do if you want to use a sample? You will have to import your database. You will have to put your license key. There, you will be able to add some 2D overlays directly inside the Android view. You can use Android widgets to represent 2D data on top of the 3D view. And there you will be able to add 3D objects too, because there is a class for this. You can add everything that is related to Android, your business logic, sound, vibration, everything goes there. So the interesting thing is there. You have in the sample three important classes. The sample application session, this is where we put your license key. And then we go to these two other classes. You have one activity, object targets. You start from there. You can modify it. You can add your own overlays, 2D overlays. You can add your business logic. You can add everything. It's classic Android development. So nothing new there. And the object renderer. This class will perform everything that is related to OpenGL rendering. And it will gives you, you will have one method, which is render, and you will go there to put all your objects. It will be pretty simple. It simplifies everything that is related to the initialization of the engine. So let's do the first thing that I talked about, adding a database. So we did our database, we downloaded it, we had a zip file, you just unzip it, and you put it in your asset folder. You can put it everywhere you want, because you are not restricted. When you run the data set, you are not restricted to the resource folder. Here, I use the resource folder, but you can use an SD card or whatever you want. And this is a small snippet that is used to load our database. So the tracker manager, as I said in the previous slide, is a singleton. So we get a singleton. From there, we will ask for the object tracker object. And this is inside this tracker object that we will load our database, like I said before. And we can activate your data set. You can put as many databases as you want here, load them at the initialization of your application, and switch by activating them if you have a specific use case with a specific use case. So, the simplest part, adding the 2D widget. So we'll do it very fast. It's just adding text view. As you see, I'm not a designer, so it's very simple. Text view, text, that's all. And it will be rendered, so it will get rendered on top of your camera view at any time. You won't have to take care of the Z distance or stuff like that. That you will have to take care in 3D. So adding 3D object. This is maybe the most complex part of the operation. So if you want to do AR and if you want to do visual feedback, you have to add a 3D object to your application. And this is where you are starting to use OpenGL. This is where you will use the matrices. This is the first fun part of it. So with that, what we will do on this use case? We have added axis object. What are axis objects? It represents the origin of the center of your object. Why do we use that? We use that because it will help you a lot to familiarize yourself with this virtual space. When you start working with 3D, as I said before, you may encounter some problem with matrix composition, and so your object may go in, you don't know where, not in a good place. So with this axis, you will be able to see, I will show you later, where you are relatively to the object. Then we will add some box object, overlay object, and then in the end we will add text object. Why do I add this here? Because in OpenGL it's not easy to do text object. So we used an external class provided by that is freely usable for commercial use that make it really simple. So axis object. That's why we are using axis. Here, my object is represented exactly as I wanted. But if I did my database the wrong way, for example, if I converted my image here, I will see my coordinate in the wrong way. So that's why we use this. With this, you can see that here it's your x axis. You can see that here goes your z axis and here your y axis. With that, you can say, okay, I'm not okay with being centered here. I want to translate my object and I want the axis here. So once you have this, you can easily understand that you have to move on the x axis on the right from, I don't know, 5 units, and you will have your object centered as you wish. So it's really important to start with axis because it will give you it will make it easier to develop your application. So how do we create this axis? Pretty simple, we use some line objects that are already provided, that were already provided by the sample. Why do I show this? Because if you want to create your own line objects, you will see that here it's pretty simple. You create your object, you set your origin, you set your destination, you set your color, and here you draw them. Easy. This one goes on X, this one goes on Y, this one goes on Z. Simple. Now let's look at at what goes besides this. The real creation of our line. So in OpenGL, everything is described with what is called a vertex buffer. A vertex buffer is based on an array of points. In this array, you will put all your vertices description. For example, for our axis, we have the origin and then the destination. So why it is important to know that you are using vertex buffers? Because this buffer will be sent directly to your graphic card. you won't, your CPU won't do any operation on it, and you won't do mathematics on them. They will be sent directly to your graphic card. And how is it done? It's something that was introduced in the years 2000. It was called Transformer Lightning. It was something that allows developers to use directly micro shader CPU directly inside the graphic card with what is called shaders. So you have two kinds of shaders to represent your object. You have vertex shader. So the vertex shader are used to apply transformation on the description of your object. For example, when you will want to move your object, you don't really necessarily, you don't move it directly. You just say, okay, I have this matrix, the famous matrix, my transformation matrix. I will apply it directly on the shader, and it will be sent to your graphic card. Coloring, making our object, giving some color or texturing our objects is done with a fragment shader. Fragment shader is taking care of points. So with a fragment shader, you can define here, for example, a color, and it will be applied on all the sides of your object. So you have these two things. The first goes for the description of your object in terms of 3D points, and the second one provide a way to color them or add texture on everything that is related to pixels. So here, just for information, for your information, this is how we create the shader. This is how we compile them before sending them to the graphic card. So this is pretty complex. This is how you render a line. So that's why we use more higher level object, because you don't want to do that right now. At first you want to use the simplest object to work. So to make it fast, we just get some pointers on our shaders. We just say, okay, on the color I want to put this, on my transformation I want to put this matrix. I want to get my vertices from this buffer, and then you just execute a method GLDrawArrays that will pass every vertices and apply the transformation, and then it will pass the fragment shader on every pixel and it will render the color. Okay, so this was the line axis. So there we are, the same but for our axis, the whole axis. Here, important thing, we are in the render frame, we are in the object target class, the one that takes care of everything related to OpenGL. At every frame, we get a projection matrix, which is the projection of your camera, and this projection matrix will be applied to your object to put it in the right place on your view. If you want to change the place of this object related, if you remember the camera space, everything is related to the camera, to what you are seeing. If you want to see it there, you will be able to apply a transformation here. And you will see later that it is very simple. Here in the render frame, we can access to the state object. The state object gives you information of what is going on your tracker. What is tracked actually, how many objects are tracked, and most important thing, where are they? It's the getPose method. The getPose method, you use it to get this famous matrix. And with this matrix, you know where is actually your object in your field. And then you can apply whatever you want, some translate, some rotation, so whatever you want to pose your overlay on top of the real object. Here, we used, we compose directly the projection matrix directly to the position of our object, which means that our object will always be centered. You will see your axis always on the center of the world you are looking at. And there, the matrix. Okay, another part. As I said before, you can scale, you can rotate, you can test, translate with matrix. You can do it in the order you want. You will see the result. So here, it's just an example. First and first, we get our position just right here in what is called UW matrix underscore before, yeah, we get it here as a float array. And then we can apply transformation. Here, a rotation on our UW matrix on the x-axis by 90 degrees. Here, 45 degrees on the y-axis is here 180 on the z-axis. You can do whatever you want. And as you see, it's not as complicated as it may be. It's just using object and say, okay, here I rotate, here I translate, here I scale, and then in the end, I project here by multiplying my model view matrix created here with the projection matrix, which we have later on. We get the model view projection, and the model view projection is passed to our axis, and so if you go to your axis, it will apply, it will go through the lines. It will give this matrix to the fragment shader, and it will apply it on the light, and it will render it exactly where you wanted it to be. Cube overlays, a little bit more complex. So here you will have to describe all the vertices of all your faces, front, back, left, right, everything. And all vertices are defined as All faces of the cube will be rendered as triangles. So you have two triangles per faces. So here, for example, we have point 0, 1, 2 that will describe here the first triangle. It's here. You have to provide an array of indices. And here, the second one will be 2, 0, 2, 3. So it's just for your knowledge. But you will may have to, if you want to do cube overlay, you will have to provide all these things. So the text is not easy. You cannot do easily text on OpenGL because everything you do is related to texturing. So the only way to do text is to render your fonts inside the texture and put it in a strip, a triangle strip. So the a set of faces. So since it's difficult to do, we used an implementation that is that you can use freely on commercial and not commercial project, and this allows us to render some text on top of the object. More feedback, we added a tone generator, we added a vibrator, so for audio sensory input and haptic input, and then we added some DataWatch from scanning to our application thanks to DataWatch. Unfortunately, I had some problem with my with one of my devices, so the other one doesn't have the scanning implementation on it. Sorry for that. So we will do it manually, please. No. Yes. This is. No. So it is. So right now I will show you the demo. Okay. So. So I have my palette one. and palette 2 here. So, first thing, you need to take care of the focus. So you have two ways of doing it. You can use an autofocus, which will the camera will focus on the on the object that is in center. What? Start things. We have two ways of selecting a palette. We can do it manually like that. It's not very simple. Or we can use a QR code here. Okay, so right now I need to find what object is going to what. Yeah, I think. Can we put the light a little bit lower, please? I think it's. Yeah. What is going on? I don't have any sleep. It's no good. You woke up. Can you put back a little bit of light, please? I'm sorry. Not so much.
Little one.
Okay. I'll do something at work. Please, come on.
Can you stand up?
Don't do that to me, not today.
I've been waiting to get a good picture.
But it's supposed to be faster than this. I will do it on the table. Our text is on the link in 3D. And if you click like that, it's on the other side. And the axes are really interesting because they show you where you are. If I want to put my text like that, I had to put it on top. Yeah, it's cool. So let's try again the fast.
Again,
it doesn't recognize the table. Oh, too bad. You have to rely on. So, do you have questions? Maybe? You can ask. Feel free to ask.
You said before you also giving you the possibility to choose CPU, GPU.
If you don't have it with GPU, it will use a CPU. But it will be software that is made, it's OpenGL. In fact, everything that is related to 3D rendering and composition can be done in software if you don't have a GPU that has a shading engine. This is a different use case. For this, you need either to have very good tracking infrastructure to track your position. You can use that, or you can use trackers that you put inside your view. And some, for example, if you put some QR codes on the walls and you detect them with the gateways, you get their position, and so you can know where you are relatively to these QR codes, or if you put them on the ground like that. And then you will be able to render things on top of there. So you have the two possibilities. The first one is really using some the NFL tracking tracking method that they use. So either you track precisely where you are and where your camera is, which can be very complicated, or you can use directly what the camera is seeing to understand where you are. And for example, if you do that in an airport, you can use the advertisement. You can use, for example, the shops have always have their names and stuff like that. You can use them, that can extract that, and then you can know where you are inside the airport. Same thing if you do this in a warehouse, you put lots of posters everywhere to make things cool, and then you will be able to do augmented reality without having to use a tracker to track the people.
Okay. I think maybe pick by light could replace some pick by light facilities as well.
Pick by light?
Yeah, for example, just if you use the augmented reality instead to light up different bins where you should be from. Instead of having a pick by light.
Not to my knowledge. Not to my knowledge. It's interesting.
Laurent, question for me. Are we going to share the code for people so they can see the augmented reality?
Yes, we can.
That's useful. Would it be useful if we share the code?
Yeah.
Okay. You will have to go in France.
Can you explain how the player recognition works, the
play thing,
I mean?
Oh.
Just for curiosity.
I don't have all the details on that. Maybe so, you know exactly how it's based on the tracker inside.
It's an ultra wideband solution that we have for the location. And they are taking around 5 gigahertz. It's taking 10 samples at a second, so they are able to track them very precisely, the acceleration, the rotation of the shoulder, because it's inside the pad of the shoulder.
Ah, okay.
Is that NFL, yeah?
Also for soccer.
Sorry?
Also for soccer, yeah. Okay. it's used for saying to it's not the same to the, our technology, but for saying the desired for baseball. You have lots of image of augmented reality.
We do it on the donkey derby as well in Dubai. So we track the donkeys as they're riding us.
Well, we can track everything.
Yeah, anything you
want to
track.
Maybe just out of curiosity, wouldn't it be easier to have two cameras in front for each? Or is the one camera is enough and the second will be just consuming more power?
One camera is enough, but two cameras can be useful if you want to do markerless tracking. If you don't have, for example, color contrast, to use image-based tracking. You can use two cameras to extract depth from what you are seeing using the parallax. And then you can do markerless tracking, which is based on the form of your object. On shape of your object. But it's if you are using tracking based on images, one camera is really enough.
So you are not going to implement the Tango from Google into the device, into your devices?
Since Tango relies on two cams?
Not the current one, but it's going to be in the future.
Later. I don't know. I don't have the answer, sorry.
This was the question how to orient in the marker, the alignment into the area, and also the view, the codes that you mentioned that can be put into the logo can be used for the same, or it's not necessary that we just can use the logo as is for...
You can use directly the logo.
So it's not quicker or something like that, the marker?
The marker must be used to add information directly inside the logo that you extract when you detect it. That's how it is used. But you can directly use the marker, the logo, if you as an image you recognize. If you don't want to have complex information put inside your marker.
Maybe just question: what will be the quickest and the easiest for the camera to detect during what's the easier? It's
To the images, to the recognition. I think it's easier. Yes. As long as your image is has lots of contrast, that gives you some contrast, it's good. For example, if it's a logo that is white, that is written in light gray on white, it will work more than work well. But if you take a look at, for example, the gray logo that is red, white on red, it's much more easier to recognize. So it really depends. But you can use, if your architecture doesn't change a lot, you can go there, take a picture with your camera, extract one zone with the logo and even the top side of the door, or I don't know, some bricks stuff, and use it directly inside the engine. The more you provide color information and contrast-based information, the more your detection will be efficient.
May I expand a little bit the question? Let's say if we have some simple application, something like planogram compliance, is it a good idea to try directly with 2D images?
You can try directly with 2D images to do planogram. But you will have to put some references. For example, for a planogram, you have several layers where you put your products. So you will have to have some kind of specific tracker or specific images to understand which shelf you are, which is the same thing as a palette, which palette you are wanting to check. And then you will have to use directly the images on your objects, since a lot of retail objects are cubical like that, or cylindrical. You can recognize bottle, a bottle of Coca-Cola, for example, or a can of Coca-Cola or a can of beer. You can recognize serials, stuff like that directly with 2D image recognition. So it's possible to do a real-time planogram with such technology. And for more complex objects, you can either scan them, but it's pretty long. And a better way is what they are going to provide is to ask your customer to bring you the CAD file, the 3D definition of your object, and put it directly in the object. Any other questions? Matrices, maybe? No? Okay, so thank you very much for attending.